Yeah, but I'll say it, goon hockey. It doesn't work anymore. Because if you get yourself in a situation with a certain or particular referee who's having a bad night, you're going to spend half your day in the sin bin on stupid calls like roughing or... These guys are all human. And they're allowed to have bad days. But when it affects the game and it affects the morale of the team, is there anything you guys can do about that to the league? Some of these guys are awful. They're just awful. They should be down at the junior league. Because the game's just too damn fast for them, and they can't admit to it. Three guys is not enough. We need four even at this level, but again, there's money is the criteria for that.
Well, yeah, and obviously, and one thing that I think people forget at our level is these referees are learning too. You know,
exactly.
And that's, you know, obviously, I'm the first one, and there's a guy... Won't name his name, but as a rookie assistant coach, chased a guy across the ice in the playoffs after we lost the game in double overtime, and I had to write a hefty check for it. But, you know, you got to remember, like, some of these guys are coming up from the SPHL, USHL, where that's a huge jump. You know, you would never really ask a player to go from the USHL to pro hockey, but you're asking a ref to come from that stretch. So, like, I can only imagine as a player having to make that jump where, you know, like as a player, you go from the USHL, you usually play college hockey, and then you spend 4 years there, and then you get to play pro. These guys go straight. So I understand, yeah, like there's definitely frustrations, but a lot of the problem is a lot of people don't want to take the grief as a ref, so there's not as much of a talent pool you know. So it's one of those things as a coach now, as I've evolved, as now this is my fifth year coaching, is... You know, you got to kind of learn to maybe pick your spots and fight the battles that, you know, maybe that are worthwhile.
As a fan, I have found myself sticking up for the referee at some point.
Yeah.
And the guy can only be so many places, and they're not nearly as fast as the hockey players. What I said, it's all about the speed. And when you only have a three-man team, there's somebody slashing and spearing behind him. You know he is. You just got to wait till you get caught. Thank you so much.
No problem. Thank you, Louis. Doug, obviously, you've been on the inside track forever in the American Hockey League. I'm sure they're doing the analysis of what referees can go on to the National Hockey League, what referees we need to work out of the game that goes along. Can you give us any insight on what type of analysis is done on the officiating in professional hockey?
Well, you're right, and Kirk's really right. It's a very exactly involved at the AHL level and NHL level. It's really a tough market. It's tough to get the referees to want to do it. It's a thankless job. They're never right. So and you know they're beaten on. So it's really tough. I mean, there's all types of referee camps, and we go to that in the American Hockey League. There was a deal with the National Hockey League, so like 67% of the games in the AHL are referees, NHL referee trainees, and they get their supervisors at every game, so they get graded to see when a promotion is going to take place or when they can make the next step. And what we found out in the American Hockey League, it was often the other 33% that we got from the college ranks, from the East Coast Hockey League, the SPHL, that really, really were attentive, really wanted to work hard at what they were doing and get to the next level. But it is a tough market, and it's not growing by enthusiasm. I mean, there's just not a whole lot of enthusiastic people out there that want to go and just be beaten up every day. So I think and more times I'm one to say that be polite and be kind, and you're probably going to get the right call. The more you're against them, they're going to be against you.
All right, Ann, I believe you had a question that you wanted to pose.
Well, I don't know if it's a question or if anybody can even answer it. It's along Louis' line here, but on the referees, everybody understands they can't see everything, et cetera, et cetera. But there has been times where we come to the arena and we look at the sheets, we see who's there that night, and we know exactly what the outcome is going to be. Because that referee calls the same calls every night, and if they don't like Redding, every time they come to us, we spend the night in the box. Now, my question is somebody watching that? Is there an official?
Yeah, there actually usually is a supervisor there who we speak with pretty regularly.
So you guys do have
actually,
a
we
say.
Have a pretty good relationship with the guy that does most of our games. His name's Jim Doyle. He's out of Philadelphia. And, you know, he does a great job. Like, he reffed at our level and before. You know, like you said, there's some guys that you know come in and it might be trouble, but some of those guys are gone and they're done and they're out of the game because they're not willing to. Same as a player, you know, it's not really any different. If a guy's not willing to get better and learn, you know, a lot of times they end up weeding themselves out too. Might be a little bit slower, but just because there's not as many referees and there's more demand, right? Whereas with a player, if it's not working out, you can go find another one. And that's one of the issues, obviously, that Doug kind of mentioned with regards to just not having enough referees because it's a thankless job, right? And, you know, we're sitting here complaining about them, and it's August, you know? And we got 2 months before we really got to start complaining about them.
We'll really be complaining then. Chris McCarthy, have you ever had a referee where you felt like, boy, this guy's got it in for me out there right now? It's just everything I do, I can't do anything right.
Myself personally, no. I just try to be.
You're too much of a nice guy.
So, I try to gain the advantage in the face-off circle with him. So.
All right, trivia question: leading scorer Royals playoffs last year.
Chris McCarthy.
Thank you very much. We had five assists. Had a five-game assist streak during playoffs for Chris last year. We had trouble scoring goals in that playoff. Really, it was all the. I thought that our team played great. I thought our goaltending was great. I thought you guys basically outplayed Brampton in every game. Just could not find the back of the net. That's like you're missing three footers, I guess. What was your take out of that playoff series, Chris?
Yeah, I mean, like you said, every night was a one-goal game. Couple overtime games. I mean, it was just really inches when it came down to it. And both goaltenders on each team played great. It was a hard-fought series. I mean, if you look from the regular season, games were, you know, 5-2, 6-3, playing against Brampton. And then in the playoffs, I think almost every game was 2-1 overtime games. And
they had the goaltender, Zach Fucale, who's a Montreal draft pick. I thought he played very well in the series, but so did Mark Dekanich. I thought Mark Dekanich was great for us. I thought you guys played great. It's one of those things, I keep talking about bounces, how important they are in playoffs. It seemed like we had the bounces, particularly in the overtime games. We had two overtime losses in that series. When was the last time the Royals won an overtime game in playoffs? When was the last time Royals won? Yes, Louie. Yeah, it would be 5 years ago. It would be the Kelly Cup Finals, actually, against the Stockton Thunder. Does anyone want a game one? And I know this gentleman's going to know. Several people have already said Nikita Kashirsky scored the overtime game winner in that one. Last time, six consecutive playoff overtime losses over the last 5 years for the Royals, including a couple that have ended the series. Who scored the overtime winner in 2016 to end the series? He ended the series in 2016 for the Wheeling Nailers. Game 7, overtime. Who scored that goal? Anyone want to take a guess at that? Riley Brace scored that goal for them. Riley Brace. Questions out here for yes, sir. Good. Grab that from you.
The teams that disbanded, Alaska and Elmira, what happens to those players?
It's a really good question.
They became unrestricted free agents in April or right after the season ended, basically. So they were free to sign wherever they wanted.
You had the rights to one of those players in a future considerations deal.
Yeah, we traded for Sebastian Silvestre from Elmira. It was probably, well, it was really their only player last year. But he decided to go to Belfast in the English League.
We have another guy that went to the English League. I'll give you a Yannick Tifu bobblehead to somebody who tells me who else, former Royal, one of the all-time greats, went to play in England this year. Who was that? Yes, ma'am. Oh, he went to France. Who went to England? Anybody want to take a guess for a Yannick Tifu bobblehead? Ian Waters, who said it? We'll give you a bobblehead, too, so you can give that to your favorite friend. How about that? Ian Waters playing in England. All right, questions for the panel. Got one out here. Microphone, where is it? There it is. Yes, sir.
All right. Going back to the youth, our active players, where did you spend most of your time in youth hockey? Not juniors, but down in the youth level.
Steven, or? Right down the line. That's a great question. How did you get started, and how did the development process? Nick Luco.
So I started out playing for the Quakers at Iceline, and then I played Junior Flyers, and from there I played Team Comcast, which is now Team Virtua.
I started off at Face-Off Glaciers.
And then went to Vermont, right? You went University of Vermont from there.
Yeah, I played a year in Dubuque in the USHL, and then I went to Vermont.
So I started off with the Glaciers, which I don't think they're a team anymore. I'm pretty sure it's like Bucks County Generals or something. And then I went to see the Minutemen sweatshirt right there. Played for the Minutemen growing up my whole life, pretty much. Spent a random year at the Mercer Chiefs in New Jersey, middle when I was a Pee Wee, I think, and then back to the Minutemen. I played high school at LaSalle, which is local too, and then I went to USHL, played 2 years in Sioux City, and then went to the College of the Holy Cross.
Adam, you heard Barry mention that kids are playing year-round now. You played other sports as well, though, not just hockey.
Yeah, I played soccer up until high school, pretty much, and kind of through high school, and that was kind of my saving grace from having to play hockey for 12 months out of the year. I think it's a good thing to play a couple other sports here and there. Personally, I know it's kind of changing into being a full year-round sport, which is not a bad thing, but at times it was good to clear the mind a bit.
Chris McCarthy, how did your rapid rise to stardom, how did that go?
Yeah, like Adam, I grew up playing for the Valley Forge Minutemen. We actually played together for a couple of years growing up together, and then once high school hit, I went to a prep school up in Massachusetts and then joined Luco at Vermont. Well, he joined me.
Two-time captain of Vermont or three-time?
Two.
Two-time captain.
Yeah. And, yeah, I'm here now.
And, of course, Steven Swavely.
I played from probably when I was a squirt until 10th grade of high school. I played for the Junior Royals. Growing up, and then
did you play at Muhlenberg High School? Was there a high school program there?
I played my freshman year with my brother and a couple buddies. My freshman year in high school, I played. That was the only year I played. I don't think they were related with the school though. And then 10th grade, I played Valley Forge Minutemen. Then I went 2 years of Junior Flyers, 2 years of New Jersey Hitmen, and then I went to the University of Maine. Play against the Vermont guys.
And did you know Chris and Nick before? So when you came playing for Maine, you'd look across and say, "I know those guys." Right?
Yeah, Nick was real nice to me. Chris didn't really bother me growing up. And I knew Chris more than Nick. We played summer leagues together growing up. But I guess I really only started to know Nick throughout college.
What is it like? And we talk about this with players all the time, to have a guy you're playing against who's a real, like Yannick Tiefel, a real rat to play against, and all of a sudden he comes over to your team and is your teammate. Have you ever experienced that and gone through that? Said, you know, I've had to fight this guy for season after season. Now I have to be his buddy.
Yeah, I have the perfect example. Everybody knows him very well, Matt Willows.
Yes.
That's the best way I can describe that. He's the kind of guy who you hate playing against, but when he's on your team, you like being on his team. So it's kind of a good example to answer your question.
Well, Matt Willows has been signed to an American Hockey League contract by Lehigh Valley. And he's one of those players you look at. And K-Mac can speak to this better than me. But you look at and he's just a spectacular player in every phase possible. I mean, I don't know. He does a little bit of everything, but everyone knows, I moved the broadcast booth down to where the fans are, right on the blue line where we shoot two times. And right out in front of me, like the first game that we did, was Matt Willows and Dennis Kravchenko last year going toe-to-toe in one of the best tilts I think we had all season, other than the one where Terrell knocked dude's teeth out. But other than that, it was one of the best fights we had all season long.
Yeah, I think everybody's a little shocked. That was probably 2 or 3 weeks into his stint here, and he was still getting to know everybody. And
You know, he was a little bit quiet, and then, you know, everything, whatever broke out, and him and Kravchenko went at him. We're like, uh-oh, this little guy, and he beat the bag out of Kravchenko. And I like, you know, the one thing about Willows is, well, at least three of them will can attest to, he's kind of a guy from New York, that New York City, Northern Jersey area. He's got that little bit of attitude, and not a bad thing, but he's kind of like, he doesn't take anything from anybody. It kind of comes out in the way he plays. He's a little guy, but he plays hard. He competes. He doesn't back down from anybody. You know, I would say one of the best wingers we had last year on the wall. And to say that about a guy who's, you know, 5'10", it says something to me, because he's, you know, just emphasizes his his willingness to compete and go into hard areas where a lot of guys that would be considered skill guys aren't really willing to do those things. And he really competes. He plays hard. He's a tough guy to play against.
All right, questions for the panel. Anybody got one loaded up right here? Yes, yes, question. Microphone. Use this one.
Some people have asked, because Doug's now with us, about outdoor games. Is that... Some people were actually thinking and posting on Facebook when it was announced that Doug was with us about the outdoor games. Is there any thought, since Toledo has done the past couple of years, and also with Adam bringing up the Olympic ice, say Adirondack had a chance to play a game against Reading again in Lake Placid, would the Royals take up that offer?
Would the Royals take up playing Adirondack in the Olympic Stadium up in Adirondack, New York? It's tough to say, but last year we played, it was not a very successful game. I think it was only about 1,800 or 2,000 fans that showed up. Would that just be a trial thing? We have to look at it, each one of the cases. And I guess it's, if Andrek did invite us for that, I'm sure they would if we wanted to. But I guess it really depends on them more than anything else. Can they get that? And I know they can learn from what the mistakes were last year, but last year was not a success there by itself.
That big ice, too, is tough on the body. All right, I've got a trivia question that has been posed from the fans out that texted me this trivia question. So, first of all, I want to make sure everyone knows that when we induct Yannick Tifu into the Wall of Honor and retire his number, that's going to be March 17th, St. Patrick's Day, but we're returning St. Hattrick's Day that night as well. As everybody knows, St. Hattrick's Day, if a Royal, Stevens, well, if any of these guys are with us, because they could be in the American Hockey League, Nick Lucco, for instance. Let's say Nick Lucco scores a hat trick. Somebody's going to win $10,000. It's actually happened twice that we've given away the $10,000. We gave away the $10,000 on the first year. Now, let me ask the simple question, what did we learn when we gave away the $10,000 in the first year? Yes, ma'am, in the back. Buy the insurance, yes. That's the first thing we learned, because entering into the third period, we had three guys with two goals against the Wheeling Nailers, and Carl Taylor, head coach at that time, just to stick a little bit of a knife into the side of Gordon Kaye, I think, started all three players on the first shift against Wheeling, who's all hangdog. They're losing 6-0. They're like, we don't care if someone scores again. Who were those three players? Who's this? This is an Olivier Labelle bobblehead. Well, okay, we just heard Ned Lukasiewicz scored the goal. He actually scored it. Who were the other two guys that were in there that had it? Yes. Michael Bedard actually did it the second time. He actually scored an overtime winner in that to get the second time we gave away the $10,000. Say it again? It was also against Wheeling. True. True. This was one of the great all-time athletes of all time for the Royals. Was one of them that I can remember. Does anyone want to take a guess?
I'm guessing, but it's probably wrong.
What was it? Sean Collymore was one of them,
And I am actually drawing a blank on our third. I'm going to have our person who's watching, I believe that's a text me and remind me who our third is. All right, we're running out of time. Who has questions for the panel? Because I will pose one if you do not. Yes, did someone? Yes. Oh, I'm sorry, Doug. That's my specialty, Doug, actually interrupting people.
The answer to your question is we have talked about it. There's two things there would be venue and survey. So you have to come up with the right venue that can accommodate it. The second thing that I would see, have to take a survey among the season ticket holders and the fans to see how many people would actually purchase tickets. It's a very, very expensive operation. When we did our first one in Hershey, which was the 75th anniversary, it started at $1 million. So believe me, my neck was on the line because the corporation really didn't want to do it and stick their neck out. And I thought that we had the season ticket base, took a survey to do it and to buy the tickets, and it ended up being a home run. So if you had the right survey and the fans want to support it and you find the venue, then I think it's an ideal opportunity. If you're going to show up a place and there's 1,500, 1,800 people, it's nothing but a big loss.
All right, I want to remind you people, remind everybody, about a few dates. So if someone thinks of a question, we're running out of time here. I do want to make sure we get all the questions. So if you think of one, raise your hand. But let me just give you a couple dates real quickly. We want to make sure that we know. Training camp, upcoming. Starts, I believe what we're going to do on training camp, October 2nd is a Monday. The discussion has been to have an evening practice on Monday, October 2nd, so the fans can come out and watch the first day of training camp. Don't want to usurp that, but we'll get that out. Radio Recon, for those of you, I see a bunch of our fans who come out for the weekly coaches show. It will be again at Jimmy G's Railroad House Sports Bar Restaurant, Tuesday nights, 6 to 7 p.m. Hope you can be there, but if you can't, it will be on the iHeart app as well. And we're going to start October 10th. The meet and greet, which everybody enjoys, get to meet all the players. October 11th, Wednesday night, we'll do the meet and greet there. Preseason games, stepping back just a second. Two preseason games, one in Adirondack, one on home ice. The one in Adirondack, Friday, October the 6th, as up in Adirondack. Then it's a Sunday, October the 8th, 4 p.m. start. For our home preseason game against the Adirondack Thunder. With that, I'm going to pose a question to K-Mac when we tee up another question here. But the schedule this year starts relatively slowly for the Royals. Month of October, not a whole lot going on. We got three home games. Do you believe that's an advantage or a disadvantage for the Royals?
Well, it could go either way, Tomer. But I think it's really a good thing because last year with that road trip we went on for a month, we didn't really get to practice. And Tomer's, as our stats guy, you can attest that our penalty kill was at about 65% when we got back from that road trip. And we had about 2 days of practice and we spent the rest of the year over 90%. So I think having...
I interrupt for just 1 second. We started the year last year 6-8-1-1, so for 16 games. Penalty kill 69% at that point, dead last in the league. We went on a stretch in the next 35 games of 25-9-1 and killed at almost a 94% clip during that time period. And we might address the connection between...
Well, it's just we were traveling, so any day off on that trip was a travel day. So you really didn't get to practice, and then you ended up... Half the other times we were giving the guys days off because they were gassed because we were gone for so long. And I think this year with not playing until October 21st and our preseason games on the 6th and the 8th, it really gives you 2 weeks of practice and you can almost break it down like a, you know, as a college schedule for 2 weeks and really get to work on the habits, how you want to play, system. So when we do get into October 21st and, you know, I think we go on that 5-game and 6-game stretch that you don't have to worry about as much stuff. You can kind of just let them play, and then you can kind of reinforce things through video. And because obviously, once we get to that point, practices are going to become a little bit more hard to come by, just with trying to give the guys rest and travel and all those things. So I think, you know, having a full two-week window, really three, starting on the second, is nothing but a bonus, in my opinion.
One last question here. Actually, maybe two last questions. Sorry. Any intra-affiliation events, scrimmages, or anything like that?
No, not yet. I think we're working on that still.
Unless, like, we played I don't know if Barry knows this, but we actually played against the Washington Capitals in 2012-13 before they came out of the lockout, couldn't play Hershey because they were tied up. So the Royals actually went to the practice rink in Arlington and played against the Washington Capitals, Alexander Ovechkin et al., and came back. That was quite an experience.
Yeah, definitely. Forget starting, and my two linemates, Ian O'Connor and Ethan Cox, were asking for autographs off the face-off. And I was like, oh God. Okay, this is it. This is new. But it was definitely a cool experience. You know, you had some guys that year at the lockout who had played at higher levels. We had some guys who played in the NHL. Earlier in the, you know, before the lockout ended, and then you obviously had some guys that knew kind of they were ECHL guys, and really it was a once in a lifetime experience for them to go out and play against, you know, Backstrom and Ovechkin and have that experience. It was kind of interesting because were you there for that? Like Adam Oates comes in before, he's like, you're not allowed to hit anybody, and we're like, well, if we can't, but he like, we got no chance because we're not going to win on skill. But it was pretty cool. You know, I think we switched goaltenders, so they kind of at least gave us some chance. We had Holtby and I think it was Neuwirth in net and our guys. But, yeah, it was definitely something that, you know, you're not going to see very often, but it was a cool experience.
The one thing I took from that game, very early in the game, Alexander Ovechkin going down one wing, Marcus Johansson, full tilt, both guys going down the other, crisscrossing at the offensive blue line to make a play, and running headlong into each other at full speed, and both of them yard sale all over the place. I looked at Adam Oates, who has just started as the head coach there in Washington. His face just went white. Like, his whole season just blew up against the Royals. Fortunately for him, Alex just got up, went in, got a couple stitches, and came right back out and played. All right, we got a question somewhere here. Yes?
Away games and TV.
Away games and TV, my favorite subject. BCTV, yes, which reminds me to thank BCTV that I believe that they are covering this town hall event tonight. Let's all thank BCTV, Heather Adams, and all the people over there that really helped us out. The cameras are HD in all of the rinks. All rinks should have HD cameras, so hopefully we'll get the best possible coverage we can. Yes, sir.
Quick question on that. I don't know if you have anything with the ECHL TV. I mean, last year, cause I don't get BCTV, and you could pick up all the Royal games on ECHL. They had a program. Are they going to have that again this year? Because yeah. I've tried to subscribe to it, but I haven't been able to.
Yeah, I believe they're going to continue to have that.
That should go without a problem.
That's a league incentive initiative, and yes, we will have a BCTV, which will allow you to watch Royals game from anywhere that we may be, home or away, and as well as any other game you want to watch of the 28 teams.
All right, unless I'm going to let Jack Galati make. Oh, do you have one more question?
Well, I think I zoned out on something.
All right, go ahead.
Did you mention camp?
Training camp, I did.
When does it start?
October 2nd.
Yeah, it's
on. That happens to me, usually about 87 times a minute. Yes. It will be open to the public, yes. We are back on the iHeartRadio app as well, so that's where we'll be for broadcast this year. Any other questions? All right, I'm going to let Jack Galati have the final word here, but I want to say before I go, first of all, I want to thank everybody. Barry, thank you very much for coming out. Doug, thank you. Pat Weller, always. K-Mac, Jack, Ray Melcher, thank you. I really want to thank the boys because they went above and beyond for coming out. I I hope you guys will hang out a little bit. Some people may ask you to sign some stuff, if you don't mind. We very much appreciate it. We thank you for coming out. I also want to thank you for supporting all we do. This is my 13th year with the Royals. So I know I'm getting old. And with that, it's Jack Lottie.
Thank you, Mark. You know, we do all this stuff. We do this only for one person, each one of you people here. That's why we do all this stuff. And we appreciate all that you do for the Royals, individually and collectively. We thank you immensely. Clearly, Mark, you've done an excellent job, and we thank you very kindly for organizing this thing. We will definitely have a power team this year. Flyers have pledged their complete support to us, and they have already committed a number of players that you have already seen sign. So they're going to come through with it, with the Doug's expertise in winning championships. Like he just simply said to one of the questions, what does it take to win? It's a fellowship between the players and the coach. It's a chemistry between them to work together for one another and not just be an odd name. It'd be a team play. And I think Mac has put together a team that's really a team is a team. And he definitely put together some power players that are not going to be bullied around by anybody. And you know the old saying that I've often said, if you come any of the K-Mac players, they're going to play for it sooner or later. Okay, so K-Mac will make sure that none of his players got taken advantage of by anybody else. So we have a good hockey team. We'll have a great hockey team on the ice. We have a great administrative staff. We all appreciate all your support. Anything you can help us with selling more tickets, we appreciate it. Objective, of course, is to have a more butts in the seat for the sake of our players, for the sake of our coach, and obviously the people that sell the tickets. I thank you very kindly for all coming, and have a good evening and drive safely.
Hey, thank you very much. Appreciate it. Thank you, Jack. Thank you, as always. Thank you very much. You know it came out. You got it.